This week on Maker Update, moving cameras the hard way, a circuit that solders itself, a clock to confuse your friends, pipe clamps, studio lights, and the real cost of cheap tools. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. I've just finished a project that's been bouncing around in my head for the past few months, and it's nice to finally see it up on my wall. Hopefully you're making good progress with your projects too. We've got another great show for you, so let's check out the project of the week. You'd be forgiven for thinking that Digital Bird's motorized mini jib is a store-bought product. It really looks the part. But no, this camera motion control tool is nearly all 3D printed. And the electronics are all easily accessible stuff like stepper drivers and ESP32 modules. It's incredible. A jib is a tool used in filmmaking that puts the camera on one end of a counterbalanced beam, so the camera can be swung up and down in an arcing motion. Before drones came onto the scene, they were the most common way cinematographers could easily get a shot of a camera raising its vantage point, usually to show the expanse of a scene. Jibs can still be incredibly useful in a studio or in other tight spots where a drone just wouldn't be practical, or when the noise from a drone just wouldn't work. And because the jib is part of a motion control system, that means the camera moves can be pre-programmed and repeated. There's also a motorized pan tilt system for the camera mount, so it can change its orientation as it travels through the movement. At the heart of the system is a custom PCB that allows you to connect the ESP32 controller board and up to two stepper drivers, and also includes breakout ports for battery connections, camera triggering, limit switches, and the stepper motor connectors. The motorized jib is actually just the latest in an entire ecosystem of motion control projects by Digital Bird. There's a slider, a camera focuser, two different pan tilt modules, and a few other components for the ecosystem. He provides a full bill of materials for each one, and also sells all of the components as a kit if you want to build your own. I also have to give high marks to the level of documentation here. There's almost 2 hours of video instruction just on how to assemble the jib, as well as a thorough set of written instructions. You can find the link to his instructable, all the 3D printed parts, bill of materials, and links to his website to buy all the electronic components by following the link down in the description. More projects. Carl Bugeja has created a circuit that can solder itself. This is a multi-layer board that has a massive ground plane as its center layer, but arranged so that the circuit takes the longest path possible, covering the entire surface of the board. So it's also a massive resistor. When voltage is applied, the ground plane heats up to a temperature that can melt solder paste. The resulting circuit was a little messy, but easy to fix. But having a thermal circuit that would only be used once seemed a little wasteful to Carl. So he added an additional set of terminals and a connector for a thermocouple. This way, he can use the circuit and some special code uploaded to the microcontroller to solder a secondary circuit with the correct thermal profile for the solder paste. It's like rep wrap manufacturing, but for soldering circuits instead of 3D printing. It's a really neat idea and could make surface mount design accessible to a whole lot more people who don't have access to reflow ovens. From the 3D printing subreddit, I found this 3D printed wandering hour clock by David Kingsman. This is a clock design I'd never heard of before, where the time is displayed by the number representing the hour sweeping across this bottom arc, which is graduated with numbers representing the minutes. The mechanism itself uses three segments of gears, each one ending in a Geneva mechanism to hold the final part in place. It's a confusing design to look at until you know how to read it, but pretty cool once you know what's going on. On Instructables, I found this guide for a miniature modular studio light by Imafoto3D. The design is based around a 19mm LED package, which is then thermally glued to a heatsink and fan assembly. At the back, you can find the electronics. Everything is controlled by a Raspberry Pi Pico and a Meanwell LDH driver. There's a potentiometer for dimming control and an OLED display. The modularity comes in the form of what LED package you want to use. You can use a daylight balanced 5600K element, or a UV LED, or even an RGB package. It's really up to you. They provide an instructable with Gerber files for the custom PCB, 3D printed parts, and assembly instructions. We've got a few tips and tools for you this week. This Old Tony has a great video with a seemingly obvious answer. How much does a $3 Collet cost? Cheap tools are a great way to get started in a new discipline, but sometimes they come with more headaches than their savings are worth. In this case, a cheaper Collet can have more runout, which means your tool is moving in a more unpredictable manner. This can result in poorer cuts and even broken tools. Broken bits alone can get expensive, but they also waste a lot of time, and they can really magnify your frustration when you're trying to learn something new. I'm usually of the mindset of buying the cheap tool until you know you need something nicer, but Tony makes a really good point here. On the other hand, sometimes cheap tools can do the trick just fine. Izzy Swan has a tips video on why he thinks pipe clamps are just as good as the expensive parallel clamps, and can also do some things you just can't do with others, like attaching a pipe clamp to the end of your workbench for some extra work holding options, or setting up custom clamping jigs with them. He even has some tips for getting more mileage out of your pipe, since you can usually get a single 10-foot length of pipe for not a whole lot more than a 3-foot length of pipe, so you can get more clamps out of it. And finally, on Instructables, I found this guide to painting aluminum by BKD6. Aluminum is notoriously difficult to paint because it oxidizes almost immediately on exposure to air, which most paints have a really tough time sticking to. This is a multi-step process that involves thoroughly cleaning and degreasing the aluminum to remove any oils, then sanding, then etching the part using phosphoric acid. From there, you can prime it using a metal etching primer, and then you can finally paint it. The author reports that this should pass the fingernail test, which means they're unable to scratch the paint off using a fingernail. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, the Tomorrow Lab squad are building a prototype suggested by science fiction author Carl Schrader. The prototype is intended to leverage the labor of the commons, work that is already being performed, and other tasks can be piggybacked on top of them with little additional effort. Tomorrow Lab's version of this is a secure courier box that can be transported by people who are already traveling on a similar route and can pick up and deliver the package along the way. The prototype itself is a simple wooden lockbox, but the clever part is its three layers of security. The first layer is a clear panel covered by electrochromic film. When voltage is applied to the film, it goes opaque. You can't see the contents of the container. The second layer is a Bluetooth bike lock that can then be locked and unlocked by the courier. The final layer of security is a lock for the box's lid, which will allow the recipient to access the contents of the box. It's a neat expression of the concept, but the real fun here is learning about all these futurist concepts, like trustless technologies. Check it out! All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. I hope you had a great time watching it. If you did, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment, hit subscribe, and maybe tell a friend about the show if you think they would enjoy it. As always, huge thanks to DigiKey for making this show possible and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.